get started, I want to direct your attention to our Faith Promise Missions cards. We're going to be talking about this in just a minute, but I hope that you are locked in, that you are saying, God, work on my heart. We are here to serve you, and we are ready to stand fast in 2023 at Longview Bible Baptist Church. Say amen if you're okay with that. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together. We're going to sing the banner of the cross as we start this afternoon. Hymn number 447, Brother Stu. We'll get it up there. Sorry about that. Hymn number 447. And we'll sing the first, the third, and the last. Here we go. Let's sing it out.
Fair we lift it up today, while as ransomed ones we see, marching on.
Okay, this song is about soldiers and stuff, right? Like effort and stuff. Showing up and stuff. So if you're saved this afternoon, I know we ate. I know we're trying a little groggy. I get it. The last and the third and the last verse. Let's sing for the Savior. Ready? Here we go. On the third.
Over land and sea, wherever men may dwell, may the glorious tidings known of the crimson banner now the story tell. While the Lord shall claim,
all together in chorus,
marching on, marching on. For Christ counts everything but loss, and to crown Him King, toil and sing me.
All together on the last, get up.
When the glory dawns, is drawing very near. It is hastening day by day. And across the world shall sway, marching on, marching on. For Christ counts everything but loss, and to crown Him King, toil and sing neath the banner of the cross.
And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's open in prayer. Brother Alexander, would you open us in prayer this afternoon?
Messages we've heard today already. Thank you for the healing. And Lord, just your goodness to us, Lord, just open our hearts this afternoon's message. Lord, open our hearts and what you have us give permissions, Lord. And Lord, we just love you so much. Lord, all you can do for us, Father. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much for making me seated. And again, we'll just direct some attention to our faith promise cards. Now, have you ever been in a church where there was a critical person? You've probably not been in a church like that where there was a critical person. But I've been in a church once like that where there was a critical person. And what human nature can do is we look at a thing and we're skeptical. And we think, I ain't being sold on that. I ain't doing that. How much are we? Of course the church is trying to raise money. That's not what it's about. This is an opportunity for us to be completely 100%
unified.
Good timing on that, Brother Stu. 100% unified in accomplishing our goal. Now, our goal is not just the dollar amounts that you see on the card. And I want to say some things so that you kind of get the idea of the mentality of the church. This is a mission. This is a missions conference. This is a mission. So not only are we raising funds, we are recruiting. We are recruiting people that are going to serve Jesus. Amen. We are recruiting missionaries. Amen. We are recruiting pastors. We are training up people in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So this missions conference is life-changing whether you get on board or not. It is life-changing for the positive if you say, I'm in. God, whatever you want. It's life-changing for the positive that it will give life to your family, to those around you that you touch. Or it'll be for the negative and you just say, eh, I'm not doing nothing. I'll just wait till God lays it on my heart. That time is now. Amen. That time is now. Now, I want to give you a quick illustration, and we'll get to our preaching this afternoon. I had a situation, but I do this to give you an illustration to show you the power of little things and of the church. I had a lady that called me, and she said, we were doing some stuff with a property, and she said, Sean, I was trying to help you out, cut the grass. My lawnmower got stuck. Well, of course it did. I said, no problem. I'll get a crew out there and we'll get it unstuck for you. I said, is this thing like a 60,000 pound tractor? And she's like, oh no, just like, okay, no problem. So I showed up and I just brought my kids. Ain't no thing. And so let me get a few of mine up here. Let's see, we'll take you a couple on the front row. Yep. Yeah, go ahead, you were there, come on. Now this is just a couple, yes, my kids, hello, just my kids, and then we'll add a couple more, please. Okay, now we have eight. Now I want to tell you. So we have a lawnmower stuck, and this poor lady's like, "Oh, I thought you were bringing a crew." I said, "Lady, we brought a crew." So we had these guys, and we had a couple more, and we literally between us, we just picked the lawnmower up and just moved it. We just moved the lawnmower because when everybody participates, all right, let me get you the whole front row here. Come on up. When everybody participates, that's fine, you can sit there. When everybody participates, it is powerful. And if there's pastors in here, there's pastors' wives, there's missionaries' wives in this room today, and we have to be conducting ourselves to say, listen to God, say yes to God. So this afternoon, while we have little options on the card that literally, my son Tyler, that does nothing but smile, cries, and drools on himself, and a few other things, he can literally do the $1 a month. He gets $15 for his birthday, and if he budgets himself, he can literally check the dollar a month. And my son Tyler, that just drools and shows up to church, can do something. That right there is a test of unity. Do I participate or do I not? The world balance is what we're talking about this afternoon. So as we look at the cards, as we look at the future, weigh our decisions carefully. Under the banner of the cross. Brother Billy, if you'll go ahead and come and preach. Thank you, guys. Praise the Lord.
All right. Thank you. That was great. There are some notes up here, and I thought for a second he was going to help me out with my message as well. That was really good. If you would please open your Bibles. Where are we going to go, folks? Psalm 117. Thank you. I was hoping there'd be somebody who was paying attention. Psalm 117. How many of you find it harder to sing after you've had a big meal? Raise your hand with mine. How many of you find it harder to raise your hand after a big meal? Yeah. How many of you enjoyed the meal? Amen. All right, you want to really hear an amen? How many of you hope that every week going forward we have as good a food as we had today? Yeah, that's what I was thinking, yeah. If you ever want kids to say amen, just talk about food. Psalm 115, where we started in the Sunday school hour, is a psalm which talks about God's reasons for getting involved in reaching the world with the gospel. And we saw that there were five reasons in Psalm 115 that God gets involved in missions. God gets involved in missions to, first of all, show that he has a glorious name and that he deserves glory. Secondly, because he wants to show his sovereignty. Third, because he wants to show his power over idols. Fourth, because he wants to show his ability to protect. And fifth, because he wants to show his ability to bless. Psalm 116 starts with the psalmist giving a personal testimony. The first 11 verses, I love the Lord because of all these things God's done for me. Psalm 116 verses 12 to 19, the psalmist makes four decisions based off of his personal experience of knowing God and loving God. And these decisions were that he would first decide to be saved, decide to be sanctified, decide to serve, and then decide to sacrifice. And so it is only logical then to look at Psalm 117 to ask ourselves this question: what is the result of missions? What is the result of missions? Now, maybe you're here as a church member who has been involved in church for many years, and maybe you have given to Faith Promise, and maybe you have even been on a missions trip somewhere, or you have personally supported missionaries. And you might say, well, obviously I know the answer to that question, but there may be someone here that might ask this: okay, so we're having a missions conference. Why? Why are we having a missions conference? Why are we going to take 4 days out of our yearly schedule and plan this conference that Pastor House said, the pastor of the church said, that this is the most important event in the church calendar? You go, oh man, that must be real important, but why? And so the question is, what is the result of missions? And that's what Psalm 117 answers. If you would, I'd like to ask us all to stand, and we're going to read Psalm 117 together. Psalm 117, if you have Psalm 117 there in front of you, I'd ask that you would follow along and read with me. Oh, praise the Lord, all ye nations. Praise Him, all ye people, for His merciful kindness is great toward us, and the truth of the Lord endureth forever. Praise ye the Lord. All right, let's pray. Lord, thank you for your goodness to us. I pray that you would help us as we go through this passage, that you would enable us to understand the truth of this passage, Lord. Lord, thank you so much for your goodness to us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Is there anyone here who has an idea as to what that first phrase would be in Hebrew? Anybody have an idea at all? Where it says, oh, praise the Lord. Any Hebrew speakers here that think you might happen to know what that is? Where it says, praise the Lord. Maybe a preacher, you've studied this out. All right. It's the Hebrew word. This is a really hard word to learn, okay? But see if you can try it. It's the Hebrew word, hallelujah. Okay? I know that's hard for you. Some of you may want to write in the margin of your Bible. This is the word, hallelujah, where it says, oh, praise the Lord. And guess what that last phrase is as well in verse number 2. In English, it's translated, praise ye the Lord. What do you think that is in Hebrew? Somebody help me out? Yeah, very good. Hallelujah. So this psalm begins with hallelujah and ends with hallelujah. Okay, I hope you're following along here. This means, so what is hallelujah? Hallelujah means praise the Lord. What does it mean when something gets repeated in Hebrew? It means it's a lot. Okay, for example, in Hebrew, if you said, achalti ochel ochel, that means I had a lot of food to eat. If you said, yeshlo bakar bakar, bakar means cattle. If you say, he has cattle cattle, that means he's got lots of cattle. Okay? This phrase is repeated in this verse to emphasize the fact that God will be praised. God will be praised. Listen to this. Do you desire God to be praised? Now, if you do, then this psalm will become vitally important to you. Because God tells us in His Word how this happens that God gets praised. Notice Psalm 117, verse number 1. Oh, praise the Lord. Who's going to do this? all ye nations. Now, the word nations has to do with geographical boundaries. Okay, when we talk about a nation, we talk about a geographical location. It has a boundary. It has a border. You can go to the border of the United States and Canada. You can go to the border of the United States and Mexico. You can go to the border of any country with any other country that's next to it. Okay? A nation is bound by geographical location. The word people is a word which means people group. Okay? It has to do with ethnicity. Ethnicity. I think of myself, some would say I self-identify, okay? Well, we got to be careful with that today. Got to be careful with that. See, hear me out just a second. Don't turn me off just yet. Hold on. I am an American citizen, okay? No bones about it, and I'm happy to say that I'm an American citizen. However, I grew up in Mexico. And the fact that I grew up in Mexico, and the fact that I think like a Hispanic, and in some ways act like a Hispanic, and even speak Spanish like a Hispanic, and lived most of my life among Hispanics, I've lived three times longer in Mexico in my lifetime than I have in the United States of America. I've only lived in the United States for 1/5 of my life. I lived in Mexico for 3/5 of my life. Tell me that's not going to influence me, okay? If you go live 30 years in California, you will show it, okay? It's just one of those things. I'm not saying that's good or it's bad. I'm just saying it is. But the fact of the matter is I lived 3/5 of my life in Mexico. Now watch this. Because of that, there are certain things that I can identify with Hispanics that maybe you wouldn't, okay? For example, as we came into Longview yesterday, we're driving over to Brother Mike's house, I saw this display for Cinco de Mayo, and I got excited. Did you know that there are some people that would see a Cinco de Mayo decoration and get upset? This is the United States of America. Well, they got that stuff put up in their front yard. Don't they know the Pledge of Allegiance? Do you see the difference? I mean, my perspective is, oh, wow, look, Cinco de Mayo, that's awesome. Hey, by the way, Cinco de Mayo is not our Independence Day, okay? All right, just putting that out there, folks. Independence Day in Mexico is 16th of September. No one knows anything about 16th of September. Everybody knows Cinco de Mayo because you get free chips and salsa or whatever. Cinco de Mayo was what is called the Battle of the Cakes. Okay, this happened in it happened just outside of Puebla in the port of Veracruz. The French decided they were strong and they were going to come over and they were going to defeat the Spaniards in Mexico. And so they brought over these boats and all these flashy soldiers and their French chefs to make beautiful cakes on board. And they thought they would just walk into Mexico and defeat everybody. It didn't happen. They soundly defeated them, got back on their boats, headed back across, and never again came to Mexico. And that's why we speak Spanish. Now, here's the deal. We celebrate Cinco de Mayo here in the United States, more than they do in Mexico. But I celebrate Cinco de Mayo because I'm an American who grew up down there. I love Cinco de Mayo. I'm looking for a Taco Tuesday every Tuesday, you know? I mean, I'm just one of those guys. I've never met a Mexican food yet I'd say no to. I mean, we're talking about salsa's going to be in heaven, okay? I hope you like your enchiladas and tacos and burritos because you're going to probably see more of it once you get up there to glory. But here's the deal. Peoples are distinct groups of people. Now, some of you may be from an ethnic origin that's a little bit different from others that are here in the room. Some of you, you may say, well, actually, I'm a Mexican-American, I'm an Asian-American, I'm an African-American, I'm a Scotch-Irish. You have your people groups. You may speak other languages. As we go around the room, there may be somebody here who says, well, actually, I speak Russian, I speak Ukrainian, I speak Polish, I speak food. We all have these people groups. So here in this passage, it's talking about not only the geographical boundaries of a nation, but it's also talking about the cultural, ethnological, linguistic boundaries of a people group. We're talking about everybody. So by using the words nations and peoples, it's talking about everybody. Everybody fits into this, and you want to hear about praising God. Let me tell you what I think is going to be the greatest day for praising God, is when one day we're all finally gathered together in God's presence in heaven, and we worship Him and we praise Him for being our Savior as we're getting ready to spend eternity with Him in heaven. I got to tell you, that's going to be a great day. The book of Revelation talks about it. We're going to be gathered there before His throne, every tribe, every nation. You're going to hear people calling out praises to God in languages that you never heard of. Now, there in heaven, we're going to understand each other. That'll be really nice, okay? But can you imagine that moment, what that's going to be like? Now, there's two main things God does to accomplish this purpose. Two main things. You might ask yourself, what is the greatest gift that God has given to me? Now, a lot of people say, well, salvation. Of course, salvation is the greatest gift. But could I say that there's actually two great gifts God gives to us? Because really, without one, the other is of no value. And you say, well, what do you mean, Brother Bill? Okay, look at Psalm 117, verse number 2. Okay? Psalm 117, verse number 2 starts off by saying, for His merciful kindness is great toward us. Now, you might say, well, what is that talking about, this mercy thing here? All right, flip over, if you would, to 1 Timothy chapter number 1. 1 Timothy chapter 1, Paul's going to help us understand what is meant here. 1 Timothy chapter 1, 1 Timothy chapter number 1, 1 Timothy chapter number 1, and look, please, at verse number 13. Okay, so 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse number 13 says, who was before a blasphemer and a persecutor and injurious, and then he says, but I obtained mercy. Because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. I obtained mercy. Now he repeats this down in verse number 16, where he says, howbeit for this cause I obtained mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show forth all long suffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on Him to life everlasting. So when this word mercy is being used, it's talking about the moment of salvation. The greatest act of mercy is God saving a sinner. The moment that you accepted the gift of God's salvation was when you obtained mercy. See, without that salvation, I mean, can there be any mercy upon a sinner who rejects salvation? There cannot be. That person is unfortunately and sadly, they have condemned themselves to spend eternity separated from God in a horrid place that God never intended anybody to go there, but there will be people there because they have rejected Christ. And so when it's talking about mercy, he's talking about salvation. Now, there's another word here. It's a key word in the second part of the verse. It says, and the truth of the Lord endureth forever. Now, this is the second great gift that God gives to us. Now, by the way, at the moment of salvation, I suppose you could say that there's a third gift that we get. Galatians chapter 4 and verse number 6 says that because ye are sons, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So we have the Holy Spirit of God. That is a byline, you might say, of our being saved. The fact that we're saved, the act of being saved, means that we also have the Spirit of God living within us, according to Galatians 4:6. So that's a huge gift, a huge gift. All right, but is that of any use to us without this next gift that we're going to talk about? And some of you already know where I'm going when I say the truth of God, because the truth of God is this precious book that we have, this book that we have from God. All right, now watch this. If you have the Word of God without salvation, is that any help to you? Do you remember the Ethiopian eunuch that Philip went to see? Ethiopian eunuch is reading the Bible. He has the Word of God. He does not have the Spirit of God. He has not been saved. He's reading it and he goes, "Understandest thou what thou readest?" And the Ethiopian eunuch says, "How can I except some man should guide me?" You ever met an unsaved person who reads the Bible and they say, "I don't understand this book. This thing's crazy. This book doesn't make any sense." Well, of course it doesn't. Until you have the Spirit of God living in you and you've accepted salvation, and all of a sudden you start reading it and you go, "Whoa, I never saw this before. Wow, this is pretty cool." Now watch this. The same is also true if you have the Spirit of God living in you. You've been saved, but you don't read the Bible, guess what? You're missing out. Big time. Somebody says, "Oh, I don't go to church. I don't need to be around all those hypocrites. I don't really need to read the Bible because I already know everything the Bible says." And there are people that will say things like that. There's people that say that. "I don't need to come hear you preach. I've already heard that message before." Well, then why do we go hear the same thing being preached week after week after week after week? Here's why. Because we need to be reminded. We need to remember who our Father is and remember why our life, our purpose for this life here upon earth. We need to be reminded of those things. Go with me, if you would, to John chapter 17. Jesus is going to help explain this to us. What is this truth? John 17 and verse number 17. The Bible says, "Sanctify them through thy truth." He's praying to the Father. This is Christ's high priestly prayer the night before his crucifixion. "Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth." Now, we could look at many other verses in the Bible about this idea of truth being the Word of God and truth being the Bible. We won't do that for time's sake. But I do want you to look at a few verses in Scripture that I think will help you to understand what I'm talking about in Psalm 117. And we're just going to look in the Psalms, okay? So go with me, please, to Psalm 25 and verse number 10. Psalm 25 and verse number 10. Psalm 25, 10. So Psalm 25, 10 says this, "All the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth unto such as keep his covenant and his testimonies." I want you to see there that the word mercy and truth need to go together. Can I say it this way? If you're preaching salvation to someone, that's truth. You're preaching the truth to them without mercy, that's hard to swallow. If all you're preaching is mercy without truth, that's not going to help them. I mean, you can be real merciful and just say, "Oh, just come as you are. God loves everybody all the same. No need to change. No need to..." You're not giving them the truth. The truth is they have to change. Okay? But when you give them the truth, also give them some mercy. See, that's where I feel that this balance, this very delicate and important balance is needed in our lives to balance out mercy and truth. And Psalm 117 talks about this. So mercy comes, watch this, through salvation and the Spirit of God. Truth comes from the Word of God. You put the two of those things together, that is an impressive and an amazing tool. It is a powerful weapon that will defeat Satan if we will use this which God has given to us, this mixture of mercy and truth. Go with me to Psalm 40, please. Psalm 40, verse number 10. Psalm 40, verse number 10. The Bible says, "I have not hid thy righteousness within my heart. I have declared thy faithfulness and thy salvation. I have not concealed thy loving kindness. By the way, that word loving kindness is also the same word in Hebrew as mercy and truth from the great congregation. Look down in verse number 11. Withhold not thou thy tender mercies from me, O Lord. Let thy loving kindness, once again, that's the word mercy in Hebrew, and thy truth continually preserve me. Notice how these two go together. Mercy, truth. Mercy, truth. Mercy, truth. And what's the result? The result is all nations, all people coming to God. What's the result of that? Praise to God for all of eternity. Amen. What's the result of missions? See, so you fill out a card. And then you give in the offering. And then the church writes a check. And then the missionary in the foreign country receives that, and he's able to do his ministry in that place, and he's preaching the gospel, and people are getting saved that you'll never see, who speak a language that you'll never understand, but yet you get to have a part in it. And then one day when all those nations and all those people are gathered before God because of God's mercy and God's truth, you're just going to say, well, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You're going to be singing hallelujah for all of eternity. You might as well get used to it. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Wow. Let's go to Psalm 61 and verse number 7. Psalm 61, 7. He shall abide before God forever. O prepare mercy and truth which may preserve him. Mercy and truth. Go to Psalm 85. Psalm 85 and verse number 10. Psalm 85, verse 10. Mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. I hope you will not forget this joining of mercy and truth in Scripture. How that salvation and the Word of God, they need to go hand in hand. They need to go hand in hand. You put them together and you let them loose, and the result is that there's going to be nations being saved and people being saved, and the result of that is God gets praised. I hope you're following along here, okay? Psalm 100. Psalm 100, that's a psalm that we often say around the time of Thanksgiving. Look at verse number 5. Psalm 100, verse 5. For the Lord is good, His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endureth to all generations. Once again, you've got mercy and truth together. Mercy and truth. Mercy and truth. Look at Psalm 115. Psalm 115. Psalm 115, look at verse number 1. Not unto us, O Lord. Oh, wait a minute. Didn't we hear that this morning? Yeah, that was from this morning. See? Did you realize that it starts out with mercy and truth? Watch this. Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto thy name give glory. Wait a minute. That's the praise ye the Lord part, right? Okay, well, how's that going to happen? How are we going to have this giving God the glory for thy mercy and for thy truth's sake? I want to bring it all together now. Psalm 115 starts off telling us that God is going to show us his plan for him to get glory. His plan for the nations to be saved. His way of making that possible through his mercy and through his truth. He then goes into an explanation as to why he's involved. He then shows us the result of someone getting saved as they give a testimony of their salvation. And then because of the testimony of their salvation, decisions that they make, because God is worthy of making those decisions to be saved, the decision to serve, the decision to sacrifice, to be sanctified, to serve, and to sacrifice. And then the result of that is that God's going to get praised as the nations come to God, as the peoples come to God through God's mercy and through God's truth. Amen. Now you might look at me and say, Brother Bill, how on earth are we going to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ? You got it. It's right here. It's one step at a time. You take God's mercy, your salvation, and the truth of God's word, and you tell somebody what God did to you. Your testimony is powerful. And then you help them through God's mercy and truth to come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And then what you've now done is to start a new link in the chain, because now they've got some decisions after they get saved they're going to need to make. And then as they make those decisions to sanctify themselves from sin and serve God and sacrifice, notice that makes an effect on other people, and then more people and more people and more people get saved. Multiplication's where it's at. See, the fact is that if every person in this church was involved in leading people to Christ because of what God has done in your life, this town would be turned upside down. There's no limit to what God can do here, folks. I hope you understand that. Can I say it this way? This missions conference could be about a whole lot more than you can even imagine. This could change not just your life for a little while and make you feel good for a few days. This could make a massive difference for all of eternity. But it all depends with what we do with it. Because if I say, oh yeah, that sounds good. Yeah, I've heard that before. Oh yes, I can see where that's going. Then we've missed an incredible opportunity. And how sad it would be to go out into eternity one day realizing that there was a moment in our life where everything could have changed. Everything could have changed if we had just been obedient to God. Heavenly Father, there's really nothing, Lord, I can do to change hearts, but I know that You can. You are an almighty God. And Lord, I believe that You are worthy of all praise, all glory, all honor. And Lord, I want to thank You, and I pray, Lord, that You would be praised for what happens here in this church. But Lord, I pray that You would help us to really meditate, to ponder, to dwell upon what Your Word has for us, Lord. I pray that You'd help us to be submissive to Your will, obedient, Father, to You. Help us, Lord, to be the children that You deserve. Lord, I pray that You would speak to our hearts. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, nobody's looking around, please. Is there anybody here who would say, Brother Bill, I believe God wants me to do more than what I'm doing to reach the world for Christ. I'm not content with where I am. And God helping me, I'm going to get more involved. I'm going to do more. And you'd say, pray for me that God would help me. If that's true, would you raise your hand? I'd like to pray for you. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Now, maybe you're here and you say, Brother Bill, that is not enough. I need to be clear. I believe God wants me to serve Him. He wants me to be a missionary. He wants me to be involved in giving my life. And you'd say, please pray for me. I today surrender myself to serve the Lord. If that's true, would you raise your hand? I'd like to pray for you. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Listen, don't be afraid of serving God. It's the greatest thing you can do. It's the greatest and most wonderful thing you can do. Church, could I ask you to please stand? If God has spoken to you today and there's a decision you want to make, would you just leave your place? Come join these that are already here at the front. Praise the Lord for some who God has spoken to them. And I just ask you today, during this time of invitation, to just be sensitive to God's will for your life. Just do what God's asking you to do. I'm not trying to convince you. I'm not trying to persuade you to do what I want. Just let God's will be done in our lives as we sing.
I'd like you to just consider for a second you're 85 years old and on your deathbed, and life is passing and not a whole lot of it left, and you look back over your life and you see that a time when God was working on you, and the trajectory was in a spiritual direction, and his working got greater and stronger, and you're giving into it, and it reached a crescendo. And at that point, something happened, and a fateful decision was made. I'm not going to go so much in that direction. I've got other things that are of interest. And that light began to go out, began to get cooler. Kept coming to church, kept serving God, but the momentum was not there, the direction was not there, the time that God was working on you has passed. And you're contemplating your life as you're preparing to meet God, and he's going to review your life, and you're going to be with him forever, and all the values are changed now. It's not a matter of the work week, the vacation, the weekend. Now it's God, an eternity with God, a God who really loves you. I mean, yes. And you're going to experience this, that he's really, really loves you. And he did everything for you, and when it came right down to it, we turned the volume down on what he was calling us to do. We shut the light off, shut the influence off. Is that what you want? It's not what I want. There's nothing more important than God's call. Nothing more important than first our relationship with God, but then our service to God. He's worthy of it. As we come this week, let's bear that in mind. As Jesus said, life is more than meat and the body than raiment. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. A lot of young folk here. And I know God's talking to some of you. I know that. Let's bow our heads and pray. Daniel Warren, would you close us in prayer, please?
We thank you for your love. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your kindness. I ask that somebody in here understands the mission of God really is to preach to the lost. Get the lost involved in his service. There's a purpose for what he does and how he does it for them. Do the thing that honors God, honors the right. So I just want to thank you for the message, and thank you for the people that you have in this place to preach the message. I ask this in your holy name. Amen.
For this semester, we're having services again tomorrow night, 7 o'clock. Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, and Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. I'm going to invite you all back. It's going to be really good. And let the Lord speak to you, and pray as we go through the week. Let's pray that God will speak to us. You're dismissed.
There's dessert next door, too.
And apparently we have dessert next door, so.
Sorry for me.
Being a free